Good morning, students. Is the audio and video is being clear for you? Can you read it properly?
Yes, sir.
Okay, and fine. Only very few people they have got into the class. Only 39 out of 60. It's been very, very less. It becomes problem if it has been the case, and you should be attend regularly. Okay, so in the first 20, the last derivation, there's one or two points which has been missed to tell about the field components of rectangular cavity resonator. It has been there available in the material. You can check it out. I have shared it to you. It's been very easy. You can follow it easily. So in the previous topic, we have discussed about the microwave rectangular cavity resonators, and we have seen how the field distribution it has been taking place with the wave equations it has been got derived. Now we are moving on to the second unit, that is related to the microwave components and applications. And you can see that those who can access the code now, the video links are also uploaded. You can make use of that, the syllabus copy followed by unit 1, and the video recordings has been uploaded in the CodeNow software. You can make use of that, and those who are an absent for that particular topic, you can go through that videos so that it will be clear for you. And now I'm going to discuss about the microwave components here. In this microwave components, where you can find that what is the main functionality and why we are about to discuss about this microwave components. So that's we'll see, then later on we'll get into the applications. Now there are several microwave components. The basic reason why we are going to discuss about this microwave components is, once the waveguide it is being used at microwave frequencies as a transmission line, where we are using a waveguides. So we have in the syllabus a rectangular, so that I'm going to consider only the rectangular waveguide. So we have a rectangular waveguide basically, and which is being used as a transmission line. And with this waveguide, where we need to transmit and receive the signals here. Okay, so whatever the signals or microwave signals it is being passing through this waveguide, either we can transmit the signals or we can also receive the signals. So it will be acting as the transmission lines at microwave frequencies. So that's the intention of this microwave waveguides. Okay, now what are the components or the sources which is being used to transmit and receive the signals? So that's the work done by the microwave components. There are several microwave components which are used to excite the signals, or where it can be used to transmit the microwave energy, or it can also receive the microwave energy from the waveguide. Through the waveguide it can be done, and for that the microwave components are used for that particular purpose, for transmission and reception of the signals through the waveguide can be done by making use of these microwave components. So that's the importance of microwave components. We'll see there are several microwave components we are about to discuss. So those are very simple and very small components, and the topic is also very small. We can individually analyze each and every component, how it is being placed, why it is being placed, and what are the functionalities of placing that microwave component. So that we are going to discuss. So where we have the probes and loops are the microwave components, and second one we have waveguide windows. Then we have tuning screws. Then we have posts. And we have an attenuators, we'll see later on. Those will not come under this, the transmission reception. So where it, the waveguide attenuators is now another other topic, where it is been used to attenuate a certain part of the signal and which is been used as a some band filters. Now we are about to discuss this particular microwave components initially, and we'll see how it is been going to vary. So each and every topic and every component is been different in its construction. We'll see one by one how it is been connected to the waveguide and that is been used to excite the signals. First, let me introduce the first basic component, that is nothing but the probes and loops. Probes and loops. Let us concentrate on this probes and loops initially. First, before going to the loops, I'm going to discuss related to the probes initially. Then we'll see what are these probes, how it is being inserted, what will be the structure. So let me start with the probes initially. Are you following? And are you following this? Is being understood why we are discussing about the topic microwave components? Let me put it in the chat box, Andy. I'll be let me see. Okay, fine. Okay, fine. Good. Now, let me proceed with the probes here. So now we'll see what is a probe and how it is been connected to the waveguide. What are the conditions to set a particular probe into the waveguide so that it is been used to transmit and receive the signals. Okay. So for that, initially, I'll be considering a rectangular waveguide. So we can see that a rectangular waveguide is being connected. So this is nothing but a rectangular waveguide. I'm considering that. So this is a rectangular waveguide. Okay. Now, so this is a, let us consider this is a rectangular waveguide. Now we have to insert a probe into the waveguide. So this is nothing but the waveguide. This is nothing but a waveguide. Okay. Somewhat cross. It's okay. This is in a waveguide. Now, we are inserting a probe. Let me clear down what is in a probe actually. A probe is nothing but in a coaxial cable. It's been simple, a coaxial cable which is being connected over here. So where we can see that a normal coaxial cable is being connected here, and where after this we have the inner conductor and outer conductor. You can approximate that. So this is the coaxial cable. This is a coaxial cable and it is being considered as an outer conductor, and this is being considered to be an inner conductor. This is the inner conductor. Now, once we place this inner conductor into the waveguide, okay? So now this coaxial cable will be acting as a probe now. The structure of the probe can be explained that a coaxial cable itself will be acting as a probe. Whenever a coaxial cable is being inserted on the top or bottom accordingly, then the inner conductor should be inserted in such a way that it should enter into the waveguide, immersed into the waveguide, keeping the outer conductor outside this particular waveguide wall. And whatever be the portion inserted into the waveguide, I have represented it by a dotted lines. So with this will act when we give a supply, this will act as it transmit the signals, or it can also be able to receive the signals. So that's how the arrangement of the probe, it is being made onto the waveguide. With this, we can see that now once it has been done, now at what distance we need to place this particular probe? That is the major problem here. Now we can see that when this is being inserted, the distance where we have to place this particular probes, we'll be seeing the excitation structures of these probes also. I'll be showing it to you. Please, if you have any doubt or any disturbance, please let me know. And now this is being placed nearer to the terminating end of the waveguide. Okay. Do carefully listen this particular point. So this should be placed, the probe to be placed, at terminating part of the waveguide. Now right now we are making use of a rectangular waveguide, so we have to place this particular probe to be placed at the terminating part of the waveguide, and that should be maintained almost a distance of lambda by 4 from this terminating part. So now let us assume that this is a terminating part of the waveguide, okay, and with this some particular distance, now we can say that the distance which is being placed from here to here, we can approximate this particular distance where it is being placed, it should be at a distance of lambda by 4. Okay, so at that particular instant we have to place, then it will give a maximum, the power loss will not be there, so it can able to transmit the maximum power towards the destination, towards the requiring point, or also it can be able to receive the maximum amount of power which is being transmitted from the other part. So that's how the probe will play in a vital role in transmitting and reception of the signals. Okay, so now we have to take an extreme care that to arrange a probe into the waveguide. So the main points where that it should be placed at the terminating part of the waveguide is the first point, and it should have inserted at a distance of lambda by 4 from the terminating side. Okay, so that's how we need to maintain the case. Now the portion we also have at what length we need to insert. Okay, so at the inner conductor it should be inserted, the insertion of this inner conductor should be in such a way that where it should able to transmit the maximum power, it should be able to transmit the maximum power into the waveguide. Accordingly, we need to keep on moving to and fro at wherever it adjusts and which shows the maximum power transmission takes place. There we need to arrange the insertion should be accordingly. We have to make it. Okay. So at this particular point, this particular probe to be inserted. So this is how the working functionality of the probe can be explained as a microwave component into the waveguide. It's been very, very simple. Once you understand this particular topic, you can easily write on your own words. Only the thing that you should not bad the thing, you should learn the concept. So that is my intention. So for that, now it has been easily, you can find what is the difficulty here. Nothing we have. It's enough. Probe is a type of microwave component which has been used to excite the radiations or receive the radiations from the waveguide. So that is an explanation or definition you can give about the probe. And after that, the structure of the probe can be explained by using, by considering a coaxial cable which is being inserted into the waveguide, so which will be used to excite the radiations. Okay, so that's what the construction of the probe, it can be done. Now the following is in a figure which is being used to arrange a probe at particular dimensions into the waveguide. So accordingly you need to explain this and where it is being inserted, which is being inserted at a terminating part of waveguide, and that it should maintain a distance of lambda by 4. Okay, so accordingly main, the insertion of this should be adjusted in such a way that it should able to exact maximum. So that's how we can explain the topic related to the probes. So it may be asked for 4 to 5 marks. You should be ready to answer this particular question and it. Okay, it's been very easy, and soon we'll be giving the assignment questions for the first unit. You have to write it and you have to send the PDF of that particular written assignments to the mail ID. I'll be providing the mail ID. Accordingly, you have to send your assignments, the PDF copy of your assignments. And it is also sent in a circular that a quiz will be conducted related to the first unit of 20 marks, and we'll be having in a fill up the blanks or multiple choice questions are accordingly given to you, and we'll be giving in a time. Please be ready. We'll be intimating 1 or 2 days earlier to that, but anyhow, I'm intimating you. So within a week or 3 to 4 days, we are going to conduct this quiz for you. Please be ready with that and see us. Please share the same thing in your the personal groups, wherever you have a group of your class, and please share the things. Okay, this is all about the probes. Now let me explain related to the loops. Okay, I'll be going for the loops now. How the loops are constructed and what is will be the construction, I'm going to explain the loops over here. It is also very easy. You can easily understand the topics of loops. Loops. Now, can anyone tell me what do you understand by the term loops here? What do you understand by the term loops? Anyone? Loop, it's been simple. Let me hear from you what you mean about the loops. Fine, I'm getting the answers. More others to respond. I need others also to respond. It's been recording, Andy. Please do it fast. Loop, it is nothing but, yes, I'm getting it now. Closed loop, a circular closed loop. Yes, I'm getting the answers. Or a encircled one, which has been opened as it, and it is in a ring like structure. Good. Now, let me explain what is in a loop, what does it consist, and how it has been working out. The main functionality of the loop also same as we have worked out for the probe session, which we have discussed previously. Whatever the functionality is being performed by the probe, the same functionality it is being performed by the loops also. Okay, so where it is being used to excite the radiations into the waveguide. So that's what it is being done. Now with this, let me explain what is the structure of the loop we have and what will be the structure where it is to be placed. Okay, so let me take into the consideration of a front view of the rectangular waveguide. To consider that this is a rectangular waveguide, so this will be acting as the top view. We can say that the top view, you can see not front view, it is not top view, it is you know, the top view of rectangular waveguide. This is a broader the dimensions where you are looking into the top of the waveguide. And now we have a coaxial cable, same whatever we have considered there, the coaxial cable, it has been same a coaxial cable is being considered. So this is the coaxial cable which has been considered. Now we have enough the coaxial cable, and we have this is being considered to be enough outer conductor. So this is the outer conductor, and we have a inner conductor. We have a inner conductor. So this is being considered as inner conductor. Okay. Only 51 just now. Oh, we have to be ready within a sharp at 11:30 whenever it is being done. And okay, please be punctual to the class work so that you may not miss the basics. Only 4 hours you have per day today, here onwards. Okay, please be ready with maintaining the times. And now with this, the inner conductor, whatever we have taken from the coaxial cable, it is being inserted into the waveguide as it is being shown in the diagram. Now it is being given like in a loop like structure. So this is nothing but the inner conductor. It is being wound in a form of loop, somewhat some circular like structure. It is being placed inside. Now total the loop like structure will be inserted into the waveguide. Now I think you can easily understand the way it is being arranged, the construction of this particular loop. Okay, so this is how it is being inserted into the waveguide, and it is being such a way that it is being aligned into the waveguide, which is being maintaining the same distance. It is at a terminating part. So it is being at a terminating part or terminating side of the waveguide, it is being placed. Okay. And it's been inserted in such a way that at a distance of lambda by 4 from the terminating part, this particular loop is being inserted. So that is how the loop will be working out, based upon the dimensions of the loop and thickness of the inner conductor, and at a distance of lambda by 4. And at what distance we need to place, and because it is enough the rectangular waveguide where it is to be placed, at this particular point we need to place, or this particular point we need to place, where it has to be aligned. Okay, accordingly it will be aligned just to and fro here, and accordingly the insertion of this particular loop into the waveguide it is being made. So with respect to that, it will be easily exciting the radiations into the waveguide. It can able to transmit, or it can also able to receive the signals from the waveguide. So that's what the functionality of the loops can be explained. Now we have some drawbacks over here of both probes and loops. Now once the loops which is being placed into the waveguide at this particular alignment, then it is being difficult to find once again to change its position. You can consider either probe or loop, where the probe is being taken, it is being inserted on the top. Okay, it is being inserted. So if you want to align here or there, then it will be a problem, where the insertion of this inner conductor, whatever it is being made, it is being maintained parallel to the electric signals. We have an electric signals and magnetic signals will be propagating, so that it is being maintained parallel to the electrical signals which we have, and that the perpendicular signals will be propagated. So that's how it is being maintained, in such a way that the probe or loop, it is being maintained. So those insertion of these particular inner conductors into the waveguides, it should be aligned in a proper way. And that should be matching or exactly in phase, that is in maintaining in parallel to the electric field lines. So accordingly, it is being placed. So this should be parallel to the electric field lines, and this is being arranged parallel to the magnetic field lines. So this is the difference we have between the probes and loops. So accordingly, depending upon the type of propagation we require, so we can use either a probe or we can use the loop here. So where accordingly the electric field parallel to this will be aligned, and magnetic field parallel it is been aligned in the loops. So whichever it is been required, accordingly we prefer those microwave components for exciting the radiations into the waveguide. So this is how the microwave components, the both probes and loops will be working out. Have you got? Is it easy? Did you understand any? Are you understanding the concept, what I'm going to, what I'm explaining? If you have any problem, please let me know, Andy. Is it okay? Have you followed? Now you can write about the loops and probes in your own words. If it has been asked in examinations, it may be asked for 4 to 5 marks. It depends upon the way you express. Now, can you able to write about the probes and loops according with respect to their constructions in your own words? Can you able to write? Please respond, Anni. I'm waiting for your responses. Only then I'll be moving to the next topic. C4, I'm getting the C4 has been not at all attending the classes, and C4, it's been TR4. Okay, it's TR4 section. It's okay. Finally, I'm getting in responses in the chat box. It's fine. Can you able to now? Have you understood this particular topic? I want the responses and make it fast. I want more responses. Only just 2 to 3 they have responded. I want the response from each and everybody. Others to respond? Yes. Fine and good. I want that initiation from you. Then only we'll get some interest to make it the subject more clear for you. And that should be of more comfortable. Fine and very good. Thanks and okay. And now we'll be moving on to the excitations. Okay, so it's been the simple topic, the same continuation of it. Excitations of probe. The same continuation of the probes, excitation of the probes. Now let us discuss what are these excitations and how can we check out the excitations which are possible. Now for that, we know that for the case of TE mode of propagation and TM mode of propagation, so based upon the values of M and N, we have seen that there are 4 modes actually, TE00, TE01, TE10, and TE11. Similarly, for the case of TM, we have, it's been TM00, TM01, TM10, TM11. Okay, and this is how the mode of propagation it has been taking place. Now, a question to you, where, what are the modes which are possible in case of TE? Just let me know from your side. What are the modes which are possible in case of TE? Please respond into the chat box. I am asking about TE mode of propagation. What are the modes which are possible? I want the modes of propagation. Start typing. If you might have started, I want what are the modes which are possible in case of TE. Only one it has been responded till now. I want others also. What are the modes which are possible? I want. My question is, what are the modes which are being possible in case of TE mode? Transverse electric case. Yes. They are answering. Fine. See, most of the staff members, they are taking the attendance by calling each and every student. But I mean to take them in the same way, if the case, if you are not responding, Andy, the attendance will be taken accordingly and the questions will be asked according to the rule numbers, whatever it is being displaying in the roll list. Okay. Different responses I am getting here. Whatever the responses is being given now, let me reveal. Yes, most of them they are giving it. So here please listen, what are the modes possible? I'm just asking you, out of these four in case of TE, whenever we substitute the values of m and n as 0 and 0 in the wave equations of rectangular waveguide, which we have derived in the first unit, we'll get that as a 0. So that this will not exist. So this TE00 mode will not exist whenever we substitute the values of m and n as zeros in the wave equations of rectangular waveguide for TE. And all other case will get the values, will get the wave equations for rest of the three TE modes. So that in case of TE, these three modes are possible. Okay. And among these three, TE10 mode is said to be a dominant mode because it has highest cutoff wavelength value. Okay. So this has highest cutoff wavelength value, so that TE10 is being considered to be a dominant mode. Okay. Based upon the values of here, m equal to 1 and n equal to 0 here. So that's what we have derived for these three cases. We have derived for TE case, lambda c 00, we have seen lambda c 01, lambda c 10, lambda c 11. So these are the cutoff wavelength for these four modes. We have seen that it does not exist. And whenever we substitute the values of m is equal to 0 and n equal to 1 in the cutoff wavelength expression, we'll get it as a 2b. And we have seen that in the case of rectangular waveguide, so this is nothing but the A and this is nothing but the B. Okay. Now I'll be writing the value. Now we can give which one is been having highest cutoff wavelength. So whenever you substitute m equal to 1 and n equal to 0, we'll get it as 2A. And whenever we substitute 1 and 1, we'll get this as 2AB root of A square plus B square. So these are the cutoff wavelength expressions we get whenever we substitute the values of m and n in the expressions of cutoff wavelength. Now, can you tell me which among these three will have highest cutoff wavelength value? Out of these three, let me know which cutoff wavelength will have highest value. Yes, fine, and I'm getting the answers. Yes, good, fine. It's very good, Andy. Fine. So you can see that A is the wider dimension. So it has been more than compared to the B. Good and very good. So 2A will have a more value. So then it is being considered that it has been having highest cutoff wavelength, so that it is for TE10 mode, hence it is been said to be dominant mode. Okay. The same can be repeated for the TM also. In the case of TM, we have out of these four modes, so these three modes will not be existing. Whenever we substitute the values of M and N of these three modes in the wave equations of TM, then all the wave equations are not going to exist. It will be zeros. So that only one it has been existing. Whenever we substitute the values of m and n as 1 and 1, then we'll get the highest value. The same we can see that for TM11 also, we'll get the cutoff wavelength expression same, where we get it has been 2ab root of a square plus b square. Okay. Now, if we change the values of these m and n as lambda c 12, lambda c 21, lambda c 22. So for other than these values, if you increase the values, then lambda c for these values, it is being going to be less than this particular value only. Whatever the values you take m and n more than this particular lambda c 11, for TM case, the cutoff wavelength value, it is being going to be higher. Lambda c 12, it will be more. Lambda c 21 you can take. Lambda c 22 you take. Whatever the cutoff wavelengths we calculate for these values, it is going to be less than this particular lambda c 11 value. all other lambda c values are less than this particular value. Hence, we can say that TM11 is the dominant mode for the case of TM. Okay, so fine and good. I am getting the response. So this is the dominant mode. How can we decide? Just don't bad the things and know the things. Okay, so this is how we can consider the dominant mode. Now, so within a minute, it is going to wind up. We'll see the excitation smaller within, we'll be finishing it in 5 to 10 minutes. So these excitations of the probes, we'll be discussing. Yes, if it has been get winded up, please join once again back. All the 53 has been there. So 53 you need to present in the second session only. Now, excitation. I'm moving to the excitation of the probe. Now, considering to the excitations, if you have any doubt, meanwhile, you can ask Andy. Excitations of means where it is doing placed. I have said that there are modes which have been possible. So how can we decide a particular mode of propagation into the waveguide using the probes? Now, why we are going to discuss this particular topic in the sense how, which, in which mode the wave will be propagated by aligning this particular probe. Suppose we want to propagate TE10, what is to be maintained, TE20 we want, how it is to be changed according to the mode of propagation, how the excitations it is being going to be there. So that I am going to explain now. So please be connected back if it has been disconnected. Now